Started?
Started.
Okay. My question was how you take over your watch. Okay. So I started like as soon as I get a wake up call, I'll get ready, wear my boiler suit, and proceed to the crew changing. I'll proceed to the changing room, wear my PPE, and proceed to the control room. There I will inform the duty engineer that I am having my round and I will be back within 15 minutes. I will start my round from the funnel deck. I will see the smoke, the color of the smoke. It should be light gray. That time he asked me that, what about if it is night time? I said, sir, night time I will be looking for the spark. If it is small amount of spark, then when I finish my round, I will inform the bridge and I will carry out soot blow. Why you will carry out soot blow? Because soots get accumulated at the tubes in economizer. So it's better to remove the soot. And I said, okay, yeah, fine. Then he said, you can say, he didn't ask me, but he can ask you daytime if black smoke, then what is the problem? Black smoke means combustion is not proper, okay? Like more fuel, less air. If it is a blue smoke, excessive lubrication, okay? And if it is a steam coming, then tubes, economizer tubes, then maybe leak, so it is carried forward. And then I said that after that I will proceed to the emergency generator room. There I will see the selector switch is in auto position, synchroscope is in auto. I'll check some level of the emergency generator, check the water level.
Emergency generator synchroscope?
Yeah, have an auto synchroscope. So I will check all this thing, I will check the diesel oil tank level and everything. I'll satisfy myself after that. That time he asked me, what is the purpose of emergency generator? That time I said that when the standby generator fails to start, the emergency generator will come up in load within 45 seconds. So he asked me only this much. And after that, so I will proceed to the reefer plant. Before that, I will see the relevant temperature of the room. And I will see the suction pressure, discharge pressure. I will see the abnormal noise, vibration. And I will see the condenser gauge glass level. So that time, he didn't ask me anything. He just said me, okay, can you draw the line diagram? Basic diagram, he said. I said, okay. But he can ask that if you see the suction side is icing, too much ice on the suction side, then you can say that it may be overcharged. Okay, normally he says it can be overcharged. So I will look at the condenser gauge glass and see the liquid. If small amount of bubble is there, then what is the small amount of bubble is there? Then air in the condenser. If large amount of bubble is there, then it is undercharged. Large amount is undercharged, no? Large amount of bubble you can see in the gauge glass in condenser. That means it is undercharged. There is no reefer leaking somewhere system. Okay, these are the few questions in this reefer. So basically, in diagram he can ask you the solenoid valve function of solenoid valve and thermostatic expansion valve. So you say for solenoid valve has a sensing bulb in the evaporator coil. It sends the temperature. According to that, it operates the valve. If suppose you are maintaining in minus 19 for meat room and requires still more cooling, then it will open the valve and let the liquid flow till it will proceed, carry forward the liquid till thermostatic expansion valve. This is the function. And thermostatic expansion valve has a sensing bulb at the outlet of the evaporator. So it sends the temperature. According to that, it regulates the flow in the evaporator. And what is happening in the evaporator box, a latent heat is transferred. Okay. During this latent heat, again this liquid is converted into vapors. Okay, that time. And the basic function of the thermostatic is that it makes the reefer liquid from high pressure to low pressure. Okay. From high pressure to low pressure by passing through variable orifice. Have a variable orifice inside. So it make the high pressure to low pressure and then it pass to the evaporator box. These are the basic thing for reefer. Then I said that I will proceed to the air conditioning room. There also same I will see the suction, discharge, condenser level, and very important I will open the this box, lower box, evaporator box, and in this box I will see the drain. The drain should be clear. That time he asked me why you require a drain should be clear. Sir, if the water is getting accumulated, have a chances of Legionella bacteria, which cause pneumonia, especially to the elderly person on board. So Legionella bacteria is generated. That's why the drain brain should be clear. He wants that word. After I said that, after that I will go to the economizer and I will see the manometer, back pressure manometer. So he didn't ask me any question regarding this. And then he said, I said that I will proceed to the expansion tank. So he said to me, what is the purpose of expansion tank? So it is for the expansion of water. Says, which water? I said, sir, jacket water, main engine generator goes to the expansion. What else? I said, sir, it gives positive energy. Yeah, yeah, it gives positive energy. What else? What more? And I said, sir, it removes the airlock. So he said, no, something very important. I said, yeah, sir, we monitor the level. So if the level is going down, we get to know that something is leaking system, water is leaking system. So it is for that we can make up the water level also. And it is also used for chemical dosing. That time he asked me, or he can ask you also, that why you require chemical dosing. So we say that, sir, to reduce corrosion and oxidation in this cylinder. So how it can be corrosion can take place, because we are burning sulfur, is sulfur, and this is this scavenge air have moisture, so moisture, sulfur, and this sulfuric acid and corrosion. So this is the thing. So after that I take him to the boiler. I will see the boiler gauge glass level. That time he said, can you draw me the basic diagram of the gauge glass and blow through the gauge glass? So I explained him that you can, I will ask me to understand. And then after gauge glass blow through, I said that then I will proceed to the steering plate. I will see the abnormal noise vibration. I will see the level of the tank level. Then I will see the free movement of the rudder. I will see the rudder carrier bearing greasing point. Everything is fine. Then I will check the communication. Communication is okay. And then he said, what else you have in steering plate? I said, sir, we have a emergency generator room. We have a emergency fire pump. So I will just have a look down that there is any leakage or something, and this suction discharge wall is open. And then he said, what else you have? I said, sir, we also keep all chemicals. So he said that, what, you lash or something? He said, no, we have a locking system. So which chemical, he said. Then I said, so many chemicals. I said, for this jacket water treatment, boiler water treatment, have cleaning chemicals in this. So he said, okay, fine. What else you have? I said that, sir, we have a safety data sheet for this chemical handling. He didn't ask so much. Then I said that, okay, sir, I will come. I'm satisfied with the steering set, and then I will proceed. We have a generator for the three generators. So I will proceed to the generator. So he said, okay, so what you will do? I said that first I will see that this standby generator, all lube or priming pump is running. And then I will check all the sump level of all the generator. Then running generator, I will see the parameters of the exhaust temperature, any major deviation is there. I will check lube oil, jacket water, and all relevant temperature, pressure, jacket, scavenge temperature, pressure. I will see the pedestal bearing and everything. Then I will see that turbocharger filter is fine, governor oil level, and we have a flap on the top for the air. So I will see the flap is enough open. Then he said to me, okay, Mr. Patel, this generator is running for 2 days. Weather will change over the generator. I said, okay, sir, fine. Then if I want to change over, then first I will see that the standby generator, I will check the lube oil and everything. I will check the sump level, governor, and all this. Governor, this turbocharger oil level, everything is checked. Fuel line is set. It is normally set. Then I will drain this air starting line. I will drain the air starting line. I will open the indicator cock, and I will put the standby generator in manual. I will put the starting lever to zero, and then I will blow through the engine. I will see any liquid coming from the cylinder. Then that time he asked me which type of liquid and why this liquid can come. Then sir, maybe some cylinder head or liner is cracked, so see for this. Okay, Mr. Patel, fine. Then what you will do? I said, sir, after that I will close the indicator cock, and then I will put the I will close the indicator cock, and
stop.
I will
Hello.
So after satisfy myself, I will close the indicator cock and put this generator in. I will start the generator and I will put the starting lever to full position and I will start the generator itself. And then I will see, I will satisfy myself, I will see all the temperature and pressure, everything is fine. And then before proceeding to the control room, I will put the generator in auto and I will go to the control room. There I will see the incoming generator voltage should be the same with the bus bar. Okay. After that I will on the, I will put the selector switch for the incoming generator and on the synchroscope switch. There when I on the synchroscope, I will get to know the incoming generator voltage and bus bar voltage should be same. The incoming generator frequency and the bus bar frequency should be in phase. When it is in phase, the synchroscope needle will slowly rotate clockwise. At 11 o'clock, I will close the breaker and switch off the synchroscope and I will make the generator parallel. I will share the load by increasing the governor control of the incoming generator and reducing the running generator and make it parallel. So that time he asked me this, he can ask you that why you want to immediately switch off the synchroscope, because it is not a continuous rating, have a small winding wire and it can get burned. So we switch off the synchroscope. That time he asked, so Mr. Patel, what are the safeties on for this generator? So I said that sir, we have a overload trip, we have a reverse power trip, we have a under voltage trip. So that time he asked me, what do you mean by reverse power trip? So I said that sir, the reverse power trip is required when two generator running parallel. So this device monitor the flow of current from the alternator to the bus bar. Okay. And if due to some reason the prime mover is failed and it stopped, that time the alternator will cause a motoring effect. It will start drawing current from the running healthy generator. So that time this device monitor this, detect this fault and remove this faulty alternator from the bus bar. So it is for this purpose. And then he didn't ask me, but if he asks for this overload trip, so what is this overload trip? When we have excessive power, more than the rated power on the bus bar, if the load get excessive, that time this function to trip, it has a 20 second time delay. Okay, so first 20 second it will get a non-essential preferential trip will activate. So in that first 5 second, reefer plant will, air conditioning plant will trip. Okay, air conditioning plant and blower. Then still the load is not less. Then after 10 second, this reefer plant and galley side will get tripped. And third, still the load is more than the third one after 15 seconds, this deck, non-essential machinery on deck will get tripped. And if still the load is not overcome, then this will activate, overload trip. It will trip this generator. So it is for the safety. And for the under voltage, actually it is like, if the voltage drops more than 50% voltage drop, that time it come into action and trip this. And it also prevent that if we are paralleling the generator and if by mistake instead of closing the incoming generator circuit breaker, if we try to close the dead generator which is not running at all, and by mistake if we close, it will not get closed. It protects this under voltage protection. Okay, this is the main. Then this safety is finished. Then I said that after taking sharing the load, I will again go to the generator platform, see all the relevant temperature and all these things, see the exhaust temperature, any deviation. So that time he said, if one of the unit have a more exhaust temperature, what will be your action? What can be the reason? So I said that sir, that time sir, I will open the fuel rack cover and see maybe the fuel rack is stuck. So we do normally lubricate the rack. And he said, no, if it is fine, then what else? I said, then this is a faulty injector can be. So he said, okay, yeah, fine. But what will be your action if you are seeing this? You have already taken on load, and if that unit is having more, then what will be your action? So sir, immediately I will inform chief engineer. By the time chief engineer come, I will take the other generator, standby generator on load. So by the time chief engineer come, the other generator is taken on load, and then we can rectify this, because we are sailing, maybe the ship is going to hit the rock. So I will do this. He was very happy, like, he wants safety, he don't want that we are going to repair and something. Standby generator is a started standby generator, and this faulty part we can rectify. So that time specially, you have to inform bridge also that we have this one generator problem. So they can also get to know that, okay, they are having now only two generator, one is faulty something. So that time we have to inform chief engineer, and then bridge also should be informed for this. Okay, then generator part is finished. After that, I said, we have a freshwater generator over there. So what to check in freshwater generator? I said, sir, in freshwater generator, we check the vacuum, we check the shell temperature, we check this condensed seawater inlet outlet temperature, we check the feed, how much feed is given. We can see from the gauge glass the flashing of this freshwater. So he's saying, so how this is heated? So I said, sir, we supply this jacket water for this heating. So he's saying, so what temperature it get flashed? I said, sir, 45 degrees enough. So why it is like this? So I said that, sir, if in atmospheric air, if you try to boil the water, we require 100 degrees Celsius. But the same thing if we do in vacuum condition, it will flash up in 45 degrees. So okay, yeah, vacuum. So how this vacuum is created? I said, sir, we have an eductor system. We have two eductors. One is air eductor and one is prime eductor. So air eductor continuously removes the air and keep the system in vacuum. So what else? So I said, sir, that we have, I will check the distillate pump, I will check the flow meter is running properly, I will check the chemical dosing, it is enough. Otherwise, if we don't see this all, it will take air. So it should be, its level should be maintained. And he didn't ask why this chemical dosing all this. If he asks, then also you say that for the scale, prevent scale formation in the heat exchanger like this. And you practice for this freshwater generator diagram also. Whichever you have a plate type or tubular, whatever it is, they can ask for this freshwater generator diagram. I said, then sir, after this, I will see this, we have a circulating pump, booster pump, I will see this, everything is fine, normal, see the differential pressure, we have auto back flush filter, and this, he didn't ask anything. Then I said, we have an air bottle we have, so I will drain the bottle, drain the water. So he said, when you drain, what is that? I said, oil and water mix, the most white color. He said, why this water is coming in air bottle? I said, sir, in atmosphere, this air we are taking atmospheric air, okay? So this, it has a humid. So if we compress this in compressor, then this moisture is there, it will get collected. So it should be drained. So for that we have an unloader that. So he said, what is unloader? I said, the unloader reduces the starting torque of the motor, and it also removes the accumulated moisture in the cooler, air cooler. Okay, so he said, okay, yeah, fine, good. So why this oil is not good for our system? So I said, sir, if this oil is carried forward in the air starting line, and if one of the air starting valve is faulty in the cylinder, one of the air starting valve is faulty, then we can have an explosion in air starting valve, because this valve is not functioning properly and it is remaining in open position. So all this combustion heat and spark and everything is coming in this line and can explode. So he's saying, what are the safety devices there? I said, so we have a flame trap in the line. Then on air starting valve, we have a relief valve, we have a bursting disc. And so he said that, what are the safeties of the air compressor? I said, sir, we have a relief valve on each stage. Each discharge state, we have a unloader, we have a bursting disc, we have a last final line, we have a non-return valve. And he said, what are the safeties on the air bottle? We have a fusible plug and relief valve. He said, what is this fusible plug? I said, sir, when the temperature increases more than 120, so at 120 it will melt and relieve the pressure of the bottle. So, okay, yeah, fine. What else you will see? I said, sir, I will see the air filter is good. I will see the oil in the crankcase, and good. Then he said, okay, you proceed. Then sir, we have a hydrophore tank. I will see the motor cut out. And during freshwater generator, he asked me, okay, Mr. Patel, what this low temperature?
આટલું જ કેમ મેમરી આટલી જ કેમ આવે મારી 3 મિનિટ ને 42 સેકન્ડ ચાલુ છે.
સો આફ્ટર એર કોમ્પ્રેસર
એરલાઇન એરલાઇન સેફ્ટી બોલતો.
So this oil is undesirable because in this if this air oil is carried forward in the air starting line, and if one of the air starting oil is faulty in the main engine, then it can get a explosion, because this combustion atmosphere is coming in this airline and it can explode. So we don't that's why we avoid this oil to be get carried forward, and we drain from the air bottle. And we have a, so he asked me what are the safeties for this. So sir, we have a flame trap in air starting line, and we have a bursting disc, we have a relief valve, we have a these are the things. And so he said okay, yeah, fine. And then after this I'll come to the cylinder head platform, I will see all the exhaust temperature, and that time any major deviation in the exhaust temperature. I will check the all air starting line, it should not be very hot, we can make out from the color of the paint, peeling of paint. So if it is hot, that means we have to change this air starting oil, it is faulty. So these are the things I am going to check. That time I will check the turbocharger oil level, I will come to the scavenge trunk, I will see the scavenge pressure, scavenge temperature locally, and then everything is fine, then I will proceed to the camshaft platform. There I will see the lubricator functioning properly. We have a local parameters over there. For main engine we can see over there locally the lube oil pressure, sea water pressure, jacket water pressure, temperature. So I will see that, I will make sure the air cooler, sea water inlet, outlet, everything is fine. And then that time he asked me, okay, do you hear about the scavenge fire? I said, yeah sir. He said, can you explain me the scavenge fire, how it is? So I said, sir, due to the accumulation of unburned fuel in the cylinder space, and if there is excessive lubrication, and if this drain is also choked, then it get accumulated over there, and if the faulty rings, oil ring is there, piston ring, then if this blow past take place, it can have the scavenge fire. So he said, what will be your action if you see this? What are the symptoms? I said, sir, the symptoms are the peeling of paint, local overheating is there, the exhaust temperature of the relevant unit rise, and scavenge temperature also rise. So that time I will verify and I will see, and immediately what will be your action? I said, sir, immediately I will go to the control room, inform bridge, inform chief engineer, slow down the engine, and then I will proceed to the cylinder platform. I will shut off the fuel line of that unit, and then on at the camshaft platform I will shut all the drains, scavenge drains. Shut all the scavenge drain. If it is a small fire, it will subside after some time. But still the exhaust temperature is not getting down. Then sir, I have to again inform bridge and stop the engine and prepare for the fixed firefighting of the unit. We have a steam line, steam for smoothing line. So after the steam smoothing and everything is done, I will engage the turning gear and turn the engine for 5-10 minutes ahead astern. And then after sufficiently cool, that time only I will open the scavenge. So scavenge fire, you got to know scavenge fire, okay. After sufficiently cool only, that time you will open the scavenge door, and then you will clean everything and then verify all the problems. That time you will go and chief engineer, second engineer will enter in the scavenge trunking, and there they will check with the piston ring and all everything. They will find out the fault, and after everything is cleared, that after that only you start bringing in. So scavenge fire is next. After that I will say okay, yeah, fine. Then sir, I will go to the bottom platform, and there first I will check the emergency exit. Emergency exit, there should not be any, the way should be clear, there should not be any obstruction. I will just open the door and see the light, enough illumination, lights are all okay. I will see the safety harness in place, and after satisfied myself, I will see the condition and state of readiness of portable fire extinguisher and EVD. Okay, because was wearing bottom settings, so it's very important. So he wants basically all safety, so he will say. And after the exercise, I will check the main engine seawater pressure and auxiliary seawater generator seawater pressure, because maybe the sea chest is getting choked. So sea chest filter. So that is very important. Then I will see all the pumps, any leakage, noise, vibration. And check various points at the bilges, any oil, water, see the bilge well, if it's right, and then I'll feel the crankcase door, all the crankcase door, see the piston pulling outlet, flow, temperature, then I will check this thrust bearing temperature, I will see the intermediate bearing oil flow, then I will see the leak seal tank, stern tube leak seal tank, I will check the level of this. After he said that you don't have oily water, so I said yes, I am coming to that point. So then we have a oily water separator. So that time he asked me, so what are the rules for the oily water separator? So you know the rules, how you say. Okay, the rules are the ship should have a certified oily water separator. Okay, it should have a 15 ppm oil monitoring control. 15 ppm oil monitoring control with an alarm. So when the alarm rise, with alarm and shut off of overboard valve. So three-way valve get activated, overboard valve is shut, and the oil contained water is goes to the bilge tank, or bilge holding tank. So this is the thing, the ship should be en route. The oil should not be more than 15 ppm, then the bilge water generated, it should be from the machinery space and not from the pump room. Then the bilge water should not have a cargo residue. Okay, these are the things. Then we have a oil record book. Oil record book should be maintained. And in this, how you calculate this? So I said this before starting this oil water separator. Before starting this oil water separator, I will take sounding of the bilge tank and waste oil tank. Okay. And then I will inform bridge that I am starting the oil water separator. I'll see the location, start time, end time, and after finishing, again I will take the sounding of bilge holding tank and waste oil tank. So I'll get to know how much water is being gone overboard and how much waste oil, how much oil has come to the waste oil tank. So like this, then he said, can you explain your bilge, how your bilge system is working? So I said that we have a primary, we were having this some different type. We were having a primary tank. So from bilge well, the water goes to the primary tank, and from there only oil gets separated, and water goes to the bilge tank. So this was the thing for oil water separator. And then he said, okay, yeah, you are fine with the watch. So good. Then last he took me to the deck stability. He asked me, this fixed firefighting. But he didn't ask the pool, he said, what was having on the system? He said, the CO system, oh yeah, the CO. So what is the procedure? So I said, sir, if we have to do this, then first we'll take a head count, and after that, isolation of engine room. Carry out isolation, so that time we'll all shut up, keep closing valve, all ventilation fans, blower, everything of funnel flap should be shut, and skylight and every engine room should be sealed. And make sure everybody is present, and that time chief engineer will talk to the master, and then he will release the CO2 system in the engine room. So 85% of CO2 should be released within 2 minutes. So he said, after the CO2 release, what you will do, just stand? I said, no sir, boundary cooling is going on, so we will carry out this boundary cooling. So after that he said, yeah, okay, fine. Then you know, if the chief officer is not maintaining the loading plan, and if your what will happen in the rough weather? So I remember, so I said, sir, the stability problem. Yeah, okay, stability. I said, the center of gravity will move to weather, load is added, and yeah, that's okay. But what? So I didn't got one. Then he only gave me in that. Have you heard about shagging and hogging? So I said, yeah, sir, understood. Okay, I make one wave like this big. And one point after, so from this middle, we have a bending moment if cargo is there. So, finally, fast moment. soil mist detector diagram, and what it does, the have a fan, it takes continuous sample from each crankcase, and this oil mist detector have a measuring tube and reference tube. The sample is drawn and flows to the measuring tube and goes out. So during this time, if the mist formation is there, mist concentration is there, then the electrical will get imbalanced, because they have a photoelectric cells and lens and light and mirror. So it is fully balanced, and if this mist concentrated, mist formation is there, concentration is high, then it will imbalance the system, and it will get compared in the comparator, and alarm will raise and slow down the engine. Right. So this is the oil mist detector. One reference. Have a fixed air inside, and this measuring tube have this, and they have a fixed value. So if this value is exceed, like mist concentration is more, so that time get imbalance and activate alarm and slow down the engine. Diagram you have to fetch, I will show you the diagram, you can click. So oil mist detector, and then you can ask me also regarding economizer fire. So what is economizer fire, how will you get to know? It is a small fire, we will carry out full flow point. And what are the, if it is an economizer fire, how is, what are the symptoms? If it is an economizer fire, that means tube is burst inside. Okay, tube is burst and metal fire has taken place inside, metal is firing. So that time high steam generation rate will be very high. Gauge plus water level coming down, heat pump continuously running, gauge plus coming down. So that time you will get to know this. And what are your action? Your action will be first inform bridge, inform chief engineer, then slow down engine, stop the engine. After stopping the engine, then you have to stop. If the condition is worse, okay, if the condition was the tube is broken and water is too much steam and fire, then that time you have to stop the speed water pump. Okay. Because you are bringing more water and more hydrogen fire is taking place. So that time you will stop this circulating pump and drain the water also from this. And if you have a washing system line, then open this and put in the heart of fire, carry out boundary cooling. These are the only procedures. But if the tube are not bursted and everything, and only still fire has taken, that time you will increase the circulation if tube is not bursted. Start other standby pump also, so that the cooling heat transfer increase, rate of heat transfer is increased. Okay. But if the tube is burst, that time you have to stop this pump. And as I said, boundary cooling and this washing system has to open it, and these are the only for the economizer problem. Then sewage plant, similar sewage plant. During my watch, I take care in the sewage plant and all. So, sewage plant, what are your checks? So, if during your round, sewage plant is coming, you just check the air supply. Should have continuous air supply, and the chlorine tablet should be there. These two things we have to check in sewage. So, if the oxygen is stopped? If the fan have problem, it gets stopped then? Because we are generating aerobic bacteria. So if the oxygen is stopped, this aerobic bacteria will die. And what will happen? If this aerobic bacteria dies, anaerobic bacteria generate family. They are also equally efficient, same like aerobic bacteria. But these are dangerous for ship, because after digesting this human waste, it releases methane and H2S gas, which is highly toxic and flammable. So on board we use only aerobic bacteria, but on the land we use anaerobic bacteria, because we are using this cooking gas. So that is anaerobic, they don't require oxygen, but the aerobic bacteria require oxygen. So what is, if you ask regarding sewage plant, if you ask, then you say that according to the NX4 regulation, the human waste should be sterilized before disposing to the sea. And this sterilizing process consists of biochemical oxidation. Okay. So this biological sewage treatment plant utilizes aerobic bacteria. What it does, it digests the human waste and break down into CO2, water, and inorganic matter. Okay. So these aerobic bacteria require oxygen, so we continue give the oxygen supply when this in the aeration tank the sewage enters soil inlet. What we are doing is it all enters in the aeration tank, and there this aerobic bacteria we are keeping them alive. It multiply, it is digesting the human waste, and this activated sludge get transferred to the settling tank. By the further more incoming waste is coming, so it goes to the settling tank. In the settling tank, it gets settled. Okay, this activated sludge gets settled, and we have an air distributor, so we get that settled activated sludge again get airlift and again go in recirculation to the aeration tank, and this way it continues like this. So this oxidized, this activated sludge get more fast oxidized, and after that, in that we have a surface skimmer which the floating debris they filter it like this, and then after this, after the treated water is then finally passed to the chlorination chamber. So there in chlorination chamber we make sure that all the bacteria dies before going to dispose to the sea. So when it goes to the chlorination tank, that time you have to say effluent. It becomes effluent, you have to say effluent, treated one. The effluent, we have to treat this effluent, and in chlorination chamber it gets killed and then goes to the sea. And rules and regulation, the treated one should not be more, it should be more than 4 nautical miles, and the untreated one 12 nautical miles. But you better don't say untreated one, say treated one 4 nautical miles. And why it is not recommended? Because this, if you directly untreated, if you discharge it, then this floating shit, it requires too much of oxygen to break down. Okay, so it utilizes the oxygen in the water, so it oxygen deficiency can take place, which is required for the fish and plant. So because of this rules has come, that is called bio-oxygen demand, BOD, bio-oxygen demand. And one more thing is the E. coli. The bacteria is called E. coli, E. coli bacteria, E. coli from bacteria. So we also measure the count. The E. coli bacteria count should not be increased more when it is discharged. It is something in 250 ml, it should not be in 250 count into 100 ml. So this is the sewage rules and regulations. Then sewage is finished. After this, purifier I didn't take into purifier. I know everything, but purifier is very complicated. You can, if you want, you can wrap you. I didn't take him, and he also didn't wrap him. But if he asked, then you learn this gravity disc, he will ask. Selection of gravity disc. So how you will select the gravity disc? So you say the selection of gravity disc depends on the three main: viscosity, density, and temperature. If we know these three things from the nomogram chart, we can get the correct size of, in this nomogram chart you can get the correct size of gravity disc. And the basic thumb rule for the selection of gravity disc, the largest diameter gravity disc should be used, which does not break the seal. And what is interface, you can ask. So interface is a boundary between, boundary line made between the two liquid to separate, because we have oil and water. So we have to maintain that interface. It should not be too large. If it is too large, then oil will escape with water. If it is too small, then water will come with oil. So we have to maintain this interface. And this interface will be maintained between the top disc edge and the stock edge. Like this different interface. So you have to maintain in between. If it is too large, the oil will go. Okay. So you just remember, too large, bade bill wala, too large, oil is going, oil is costly also, and too small, water is going. Chota bill hai, khali paani dega, oil is going. So he will ask you, then he will ask how many operating water is there, then he will say that ceiling water is there, we have a operating water, we have a sludging water, three main things. Then we can ask you desludge of purifier. So what you have to desludge the purifier? First we will stop the feed, putting recirculation. Okay. After stopping this, open the ceiling water. Open the ceiling water, you will see the water coming out from the side glass. You can see the once the water is coming out, you stop this ceiling water. After ceiling water is stopped, then you close this operating water. Okay. Close the operating water, open the sludging water. A characteristic sound you can hear. Okay. For 2-3 seconds, characteristic sound. Immediately stop the sludge, open operating water, close the desludge, and then wait for the RPM to come. You can see the amp. When you desludge, it will go high, very high it will go. So let it come to the normal. Once the RPM attained, then you open this operating water. Again carry out, once again open ceiling water, let the oil flow. You can see in the side glass. Then stop this and open, slowly open the feed and resume this, and then maintain the back pressure. So why you maintain the back pressure? So we maintain the back pressure for this interface. Yes. Also back pressure is maintained for this, we have a centripetal pump on the outside. So centripetal pump should be always immersed in oil. Okay. So this centripetal pump is always stationary. This pump is stationary, only the liquid is rotating inside. So it should be a little bit immersed. So according to that we keep this back pressure. These are the things in purifier. Then what are the checks in purifier? As soon as you enter the purifier room, first you will check that the exhaust fan is running. If the exhaust fan runs, it stop, what will happen? Sir, the fuel will contaminate the engine room. Fumes are coming up, fumes. That can contaminate the engine room. That's why exhaust fan should always be running. First thing is like this. Then you check the gear oil level. Okay. Check the motor amp. It should be normal, like in our simple 15 amps. So check the amps of the purifier. See this back pressure oil. Open this sludge port and see oil, water and things coming. These are the things in purifier. Then purifier room you have settling tank, sludge tank, you drink the water. And what are the operating procedures you can ask? I said you about the ceiling. Why ceiling water is required? Ceiling water is required, we fill the bowl with water. Okay. So we require some interface, okay, with liquid and fuel, oil, between two liquids, we require this interface. So we open the ceiling water and fill the bowl full of water. When it is running in centrifugal force, that time it maintains the seal, and to maintain the seal for the separation, for the effective separation. So that for that purpose ceiling water is required. And why operating water is required? The operating water is required. We have a sliding bowl. So this operating water goes below the sliding bowl and keeps the bowl in up position, closed position. Okay. It always lifts and keeps in closed position and going on. Okay, everything purify process going on. After that, after 10-15 minutes, sludge is accumulated on the periphery of the bowl. Okay. So we require to remove this sludge. So that time, when we open this sludge water, it drains this operating water from down. So this bowl comes down. When this comes down, this sludge also break up. When it comes down, sludge break up and the hole is matched. The bowl hole and the when it slides down, it have a hole. It matches, and due to centrifugal force, this sludge is thrown out. And then after this, again we operating water again lift open and lift the valve. So these are the things for the purifier. I had sufficient knowledge, but I thought better if we ask, then only I will take it. I didn't take the purifier. Then what else we have? You can ask you can ask main circuit.
Heat exchanger?
Heat exchanger, you have plate type cooler and tube type cooler. So what are the difference?
What you check in that?
You check the seal. If it is plate type, you check the leakage from between the plates, that you have to check.
So
the
temperature deviation?
Temperature deviation you have to check in both the coolers. But he will not not ask like this. He will say, what are the difference? Advantage, disadvantage. What are the advantages? Main advantage is this. I will give you this in your answer. Main advantage. Main advantage of plate type cooler. You can increase its efficiency more. Okay, because in plate type cooler we have small. But if we increase, suppose for example, if we increase the engine power, we are putting more big cylinder liner and all, we are increasing the power, more heat generation. So that time if we have a tube type cooler, we have to remove this and throw, and we have to install a big tube type. But in plate type, we have small. You just open, add 15-20 plates more, no need till there. So this is the main difference. You understand? With heat transfer, you can add more. You can add more plate, still you don't require to throw all this. This is the main difference. So other difference, it increases the surface area. Cooling surface area is increased. Like say in air cooled pipe, we have a pinch. Why you have a pinch? Because on cylinder liner we have pinch, it increases the surface area. Only we don't have pinch, then only we have this only. But we are increasing the surface, cooling surface area. So in plate type we have so much. What you call just now, I don't remember.
Boiler safeties.
Boiler safeties are there. We have a high level alarm, low level alarm. Then we have a flame failure trip. Then we have a fuel oil temperature, low temperature, fuel oil pressure, low pressure. These are the alarms and safeties. We have a safety valves and all this thing, vent valve. The safety blow down, come down, all boiler mountings there. In this mounting, whatever is there in boiler, like we have main feed valve, auxiliary feed valve, we have main steam stop valve, we have vent valve, we have safety valve, we have all FD pen, full FD pen, everything is in mounting, gauge, glass, pressure gauge, saturometer, everything is in mounting. Boiler. And flash up the boiler from cold condition. You have to flash up the boiler from cold condition. Like if your ship is in dry dock, maybe in Sweden, ice is falling. The same question in my college doctor asked me, boiler. He asked me, okay, we are in Sweden, ice is falling, 2 months, the boiler stopped. Okay, now to flash up the boiler, how do you do it? We have only shore supply. So that time you will say, first I will press up the compressor, I will start the compressor, press up the air bottle. Okay, because for automation, we require this air. Now fuel line and everything is cold, so we don't have steam to heat. So first we'll start air compressor, press the bottle full, then set the diesel oil line and automation air line for the main and pilot burner. Okay, main burner, pilot burner, set up the diesel oil line and air line. Then boiler is cold and major work has been done inside. So first I will check steam side, water side, furnace side, everything is clear, not unwanted material is there. After everything is fine, then I will, before starting, first I will make sure that feed valve, vent valve, this main two valve are open. Scum blow down, bottom blow down, main steam stop valve, it should be in shut position. Okay, still running or still running? So it, this arc, this should be in shut position, okay? So first thing I will do, I will start the feed pump manually and I will just fill the water till the low level alarm goes. When this low level alarm goes, I will stop the feed pump, okay? Why I will not take full water, how much we are taking, only low level, why? Because the water is cold, requires some space for expansion. So that only till the level goes off, I will fill the water. As soon as the low level alarm goes, I will stop feed pump. Then I will purge the boiler for 4 minutes, purging. Why purging is required? Because maybe there is an explosive mixture, this fuel nozzle is leaking and have an explosive mixture inside, can have explosion. So purging means we are removing this explosive mixture and charging with pressure inside the furnace. Everything is removed and we charge. Charge this furnace pressure. That's why we purge it. We purge it with a full flap. Every pen flap is full open when purging. After purging, the flap comes to the 10%. Small. Little air. Not full. And then igniter pilot burner. Pilot burner will burn and then we on the main burner. When the flame take over, when the main burner take over the flame, we switch off the pilot burner. Then we have to slowly, slowly increase the steam. Slowly, slowly. Like 2 minutes start, 15 minutes stop. 3, 5 minutes start, half an hour stop. So 6 to 8 hours we have to do. Why it is for even thermal? Thermal. Otherwise, on all of a sudden, if you do thermal work, it will get fracture. So for even transfer of heat, okay, it slowly, slowly goes like this. And when the steam start oozing out from the vent valve, steam start oozing out from the vent valve. That time we close this vent valve. Okay. After closing this vent valve, then you sufficiently raise the steam pressure, and your boiler is ready. This is the boiler starting from cold condition. After this, what else do you have left? Boiler. Steering gear rules regulations. First, the steering gear motor should have a two wide separate connection, one from the main switchboard, the other should be from the emergency switchboard. Then second point, the motor for the steering gear have a 100% overload capacity, only giving short circuit protection. Second point is third point, should have a direct communication facility from steering gear to bridge. Telecommunication. Fourth point, the should have a rudder angle indicator, one in steering gear, the other on bridge. Fourth point. Fifth point, should have a single failure criteria. Single failure criteria means if you become with one motor stop, the other motor should start within 45 minutes. After that, should have a low level alarm on time. Low level alarm. These are the rules. And the other thing is that in the rudder movement should be able to move from hard port to hard starboard, you say from 35 degree to 30 degree within 28 seconds. In full loaded condition and full loaded condition.
In ballast.
And barrel. Full loaded means maximum. In full loaded condition, it should be able to move from hard port to hard stop from 35 to 30 degrees within 28 seconds. Okay. And the single failure criteria have two things. One is if motor have problem, it will start. Other thing is if the hydraulic line of one cylinder is leaking, then the low level alarm activate and others should. So it should effectively function. It should have. The design should be such a type that it should be able to steer. If the hydraulic line is also faulty, it should steer the ship like this in the failure current. So these are the rules and regulations for steering.
Incinerator?
Incinerator, you don't ask anything, but incinerator, what you say? We have a flame failure alarm, we maintain 500 degree temperature, it cut off, and we burn this rag, which is used for burning this waste oil. When we are burning this waste oil, we are recording this oil record. It is only for the incineration. Okay. Then you study regarding this garbage management. Then over here they don't ask this anything. Up till now I don't know that MSN, IMO, ISN, but it is important you better prepare to do anything. Because I got this, this other survey. So he asked me regarding some different person trying something like this. What else is left? Types of pump. Types of pump in engineering. We have a dynamic pump and positive displacement. We have two branches. One is like two branches, boy and girl like this. So we have dynamic and we have positive displacement. In dynamic we have centrifugal, inductor like this. And in positive displacement we have a reciprocating pump. We have a gear pump, we have a screw pump, we have variable stroke pump, like this. These are all positive displacement. Positive displacement pump are self-priming, don't not require priming. It have a relief valve on the surface. And centrifugal pump, they don't have a relief valve, okay? Then centrifugal pump are not self-priming, it requires require some info of time. Then
in lubricator, what you check?
Hmm?
In lubricator, mainly in lubricator.
Mainly in lubricator, you see the ball is pumping.
But if it is not ball, like alpha lubricator.
Alpha lubricator.
There's a blink, blinker.
I didn't feel like this, I got every time this ball. So
I sell the new ships, that's why like that.
So this is the thing, still the air conditioning.
And then the funnel flaps.
Funnel flap we have is from the control station, fire control station. We have this, this is the pneumatic control.
No, it is monthly tryout.
Every Saturday routine. It says it's every Saturday routine. Okay. Lifeboat launching and recovery. Okay. So head count is taken. After head count taken, sufficient warm clothes, sufficient ration, food, EPUB, SART, everything is taken. Then first thing I will do is remove the battery charger line, put the drain plug, see the drain plug is in proper place. Then make fast painter to the strong point, remove forward gripe, aft gripe, remove the safety harbor thing, and remove the cradle stopper. Hello. Hey Thakur, aa gaya? Kal tu
start to
know for river this is what was launching and recovery.
Mm.
So what I said, I was remove, make first painter the strong point, remove forward drive, aft drive, then remove this harbor safety pin, on the remove this cradle stopper, and then everybody board on ship, on this lifeboat, make belt and strap, everything, head count taken, before closing the door, make sure everything is clear down, okay? And then we have a one thing I missed when arranging. First we have to remove this brake wings lock pin.
Mm.
Okay, there is a lock pin. So starting only you have to remove this lock pin, and then after head count everything is taken, everything clear, then you look gradually release. We have a release mechanism, so gradually release it, slowly the boat comes down, that time you start the lifeboat engine. Okay, once the boat is waterborne, we have a hydrostatic release unit safety system which unlock, which is a safety feature. After the boat is waterborne, the water pressure acts on diaphragm and unlock this lever, and so after that you can release this by removing the T-type locking pin and press the bar with the T-handle against the spring, and the boat will release. And after releasing, immediately you steer away from the ship, and again recovery he will ask, and he says that also bring that ship to the align to the boat first. And so okay, that time you have to remove the painter also. We have a toggle. You just remove the toggle pin, and painter also.
Let the painter go out.
So after, when we are recovering, again you connect with boat hook, arrange, and then slowly heave up. So that time you want to use this limit switch. So you say slowly I will heave up at one moment, at one position, the limit switch will stop this motor. Limit switch will stop this motor. And then with manual handle you can again lock. And in CO2 system, fixed by what you are having?
Life raft.
Mm-hmm.
Foam.
Foam type.
Tomorrow my two foam.
Your foam.
Why is it foam type?
You write foam, this portfolio.
We don't write portfolio.
Ah, then
we
just
sign
CO2.
Like this, but we write some task, no?
Mm-hmm.
So we, I don't put, I remove so many things.
So CO2, you say CO2, yeah. CO2, we have diagram also, and all not complicated. So CO2, he asked me, I said only CO2, but he wanted this isolation process. So for that, I already said or not?
Mm.
I
already said.
Huh?
Life raft,
I don't know. But it is very easy. You urine, this remove this blocking pin and make sure everything is clear. Remove sufficiently, open the painter. Okay, sufficiently remove this painter. Make sure everything is clear and then throw it overboard. And after throw, give a jerk. The CO2, nobody asked, but just say that remove this hook and
class
flashing,
of fires.
Flashing. Class of fire, we have A, B, C, D. So A, don't say E, because in my book I don't see E. Because A, B, C, D, if he asks, then only. So we have class A is solid, class B is liquid, class C is gas, and class D is metal. Okay, then he says more than the class E electrical. So what is the difference between CO2 and how you can make out the difference between CO2 and foam? So color coding is there. Color coding. In color coding, CO2 is full black color. Foam has a cream color. Cream color foam. Then dry powder has blue color. And water type has full red color. The other color coding. So from color coding you can make out.
Okay. Okay.
पटी बैटरी पटी बैटरी पटी